Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Nowhere Left to Go, How Climate Change is Driving Species to the Ends of the Earth, by Benjamin von Brackel. Narrated by Tom Beyer. Prologue. It begins. Southern California, before the turn of the millennium. It couldn't have been more innocent to begin with. In the San Isidro Mountains, close to the Mexican border, a butterfly, a checker spot, spreads its wings to reveal a flecked pattern in red and black. It takes off before being caught in a gust of wind and borne hundreds of feet up the mountain. Its fate seems sealed the moment it lands. For thousands of years, countless others of its species followed the same route, a chance gust blowing them up toward the summit. All have died without leaving any offspring. Evolution has specifically ensured that Euphydrius editha, or the Edith's checker spot, can thrive only within a narrow temperature window. Should this species stray too far outside its usual climate, it will not survive. Yet for this checker spot, a female, something amazing is going to happen. She is going to live. Using the olfactory organs on her legs and feelers, she will sniff out wildflowers in this unfamiliar landscape and lay dozens of eggs, which she has carried around for weeks, on the undersides of their leaves. Then the next stages of metamorphosis will begin. The caterpillars will hatch, eat, and pupate before emerging as butterflies. She will establish a new colony. But why has Euphydrius editha failed to colonize this higher spot before, when this little checker spot has succeeded? She is no more cunning, no stronger or better able to adapt than those that came before her. If this checker spot has not undergone any fundamental changes in order to be able to survive in its new environment, then it must be the environment that has fundamentally changed. And it has. Unusual Behavior. Macquarie University, Sydney, Australia, June 1998. There was a knock at the door. Leslie Hughes looked up from her desk to see a face appear in her office doorway, complete with bushy beard and a head of fair hair. It was an older colleague from the Institute for Biology. He asked Hughes if she would like to give the opening address at the annual meeting of the Society for Conservation Biology. The prestigious conference was due to be held outside of North America for the first time at Macquarie University in northern Sydney, where Leslie Hughes, then 38, worked as a lecturer and researcher. Hughes was honored. It was the first time in her still-fledgling career that she would have the opportunity to speak in front of experts from across the world. She decided she would simply report on what she had been working on for the last couple of years, the effects that climate change might have on animal and plant species in the future. She had simulated how eucalyptus trees in Australia would react if climatic zones were to shift one day, but that was a long way off. Still, she decided to look over some contemporary studies from other parts of the world. She wanted to be sure she was prepared. After a little research, Hughes stumbled across something particularly puzzling. A handful of studies from notable journals were reporting highly unusual behavior in a number of species. These were no longer predictions, they were observations. Hughes read about ferns unfurling on alpine peaks in Europe, Mexican voles in the southwestern U.S. leaving behind a great number of their habitats and colonizing sites farther north, and yellow fever mosquitoes spotted in Colombia at altitudes of over 7,000 feet. The more she researched the issue, the more examples she encountered. Fish populations off the coast of California were replaced. Resident cold-loving species were dropping, while warmth-loving species from Southern California increased. In Great Britain, bird species were moving permanently up north. The same was happening in the U.S. One study in Nature especially caught Hughes's eye. In the U.S., populations of Euphydrius editha had shifted northward by 2 degrees of latitude and climbed their way up mountains. This study stood out from the others in terms of its complexity, its volume of data, and the degree of care taken over the survey. It was published in 1996 and compiled by Camille Parmesan, a young biologist from the U.S. Parmesan had acted every bit the detective, canvassing museums in the western U.S. for a whole year to use historical records to determine where the butterfly had lingered in the previous 100 years. She subsequently visited these sites herself to check whether there were still butterfly populations present. In 4.5 years, Parmesan, at that time based at the University of Texas, observed over 150 sites in a strip along the west coast from Mexico to Canada, including the San Ysidro Mountains next to the Mexican border. The result? Many butterfly populations in Mexico and the southern U.S. had disappeared, while only very few had vanished in the northern U.S. and Canada. Their center of distribution had shifted over 60 miles north and over 300 feet up. It was possible that these sensitive butterflies were serving as bioindicators for global warming, though this was as yet unproven at the time of publication. Conclusive proof, Parmesan wrote, would require more such studies, taking in other species and other regions. Leslie Hughes was astonished. It was precisely these studies that she now held in her hands. She was conscious that some of them displayed weak points or were merely snapshots. There could be all kinds of reasons behind a shift in habitat: rogue years where the weather was particularly good or poor. Animals and plants were constantly moving from place to place, if only randomly. It was also conceivable that people had driven these species to move by appropriating areas of land or spreading environmental pollutants. Yet most of the studies and the coincidence of the shifts they described gave her pause. It all pointed to a pattern. Eventually, Hughes gave herself permission to ask the big question: was the alarm bell already ringing? Has climate change already set the animals and plants of the world in motion? The Alarm, Washington, D.C., 1985. The idea had come to him in the shower. It was where he often had his best breakthroughs. Robert Peters, known to friends and colleagues as Rob, had just completed his studies in biology at Princeton and started his first job at the Conservation Foundation, a conservation organization in the capital. Part of his job required him to write an article on ideal layouts for nature reserves. Across the country, people in environmental conservation were discussing which was better: one large nature reserve or multiple small ones. It might sound like a minor issue of interest only to a small group of experts, but it was anything but. The topic was a timely one. The habitats of animals and plants across the world were shrinking as humanity spread. More and more habitats were surrounded by towns and agricultural land, or carved up by roads and canals. They were like islands in a vast ocean. It was no accident that biologists like Peters turned their attention to findings in the field of island biogeography, a subject that deals with how island species develop and how they die out. Broadly speaking, they concluded that the farther islands are from the mainland, and the more isolated and smaller they are, the fewer species they harbor. Ultimately, interaction and exchange are crucial for biodiversity. This could also be applied to fragmented mainland sites, such as patches of woodland or nature reserves. This information gave biologists the opportunity to calculate how quickly species in these locations would go extinct. Peters immersed himself in the material before encountering another phenomenon by coincidence, which made isolated habitats an even bigger problem for species than they already were. What had long been considered protected space could, in the long term, turn out to be a trap. In the shower, Peters recalled an article he'd spotted in Science. The article by NASA scientists covered the possible ramifications of the greenhouse effect, a phenomenon that many had yet to speak of, and if they had, they had only discussed it as a possibility in the distant future. The scientists spoke of shifting climatic zones transforming entire landscapes in North America and Central Asia into deserts and melting the West Antarctic ice sheet. Peters pictured what would happen to living beings in nature reserves if one day the climatic zones were to shift away from the equator and toward Earth's poles. Vegetation zones would shift too, and then, he was certain, the conditions that many species needed to survive would disappear overnight. Those who could not adapt would perish, unless they migrated. But where would they go? Would they leave the nature reserves? Good God, Peters thought, as the water pattered over his head, it's a disaster waiting to happen. A ridiculous idea. Peters visited the nearest library. He wanted to know what science had learned about this imminent threat in recent years. He found nothing. Then he spoke to conservationists. No one knew anything about it. It soon dawned on me that no one had ever considered it, Peters explains with hindsight. I felt like I'd found a $20 bill on the sidewalk while everybody else had walked by without picking it up. Something isn't right here, he thought. Peters knew he was onto something big. Something that now makes him appear as a kind of a visionary. Today, apocalyptic images of kangaroos hopping through charred Australian woodland are as much a familiar sight as bleached coral reefs or moose stumbling into Canadian supermarkets covered in ticks. Peters got in touch with Bob Jenkins, chief scientist at the Nature Conservancy, one of the biggest conservation organizations in the U.S., with headquarters in D.C., close to the White House. Jenkins listened to what the young biologist had to say. Peters has never forgotten his reply. It's a ridiculous idea, he said. Totally useless as far as conservation is concerned. His reaction left a mark, even on someone as stubborn as Peters. Newly graduated and just at the beginning of his career, Peters was intimidated. He must have seemed crazy. but the matter was never far from his thoughts. He had fallen for it, hook, line, and sinker. And so, he asked a friend and colleague, the ecologist Joan Darling, to help him write a scientific paper. Unlike him, she knew what it took to get published, and the first thing they needed was more information. He found this by looking deep into the past, into the work of scientists with a predilection for scrabbling around in wet layers of sediment in lakes and wetlands. Here, paleobiologists were on the hunt for fossilized pollen. There are as many as 100,000 grains of pollen in 1/5 of a teaspoon of lake sediment. For paleontologists, this is true treasure, offering a glimpse far back into the history of life as we know it. Paleobiologists use special laser microscopes to observe pollen in 3D. Its shape reveals which genus it comes from, sometimes even which species. What's more, scientists can use its geological history to determine when and how many of a particular plant species have grown, because a new layer of sediment will settle on the lake bed every year. Since this layer is a different color in summer from what it is in winter, the sediment can be red in a similar way to the rings in a tree trunk. By observing these varves, as they are known, paleontologists can draw conclusions about early climatic fluctuations and how plants may have responded to them. How quickly did they spread over the course of millennia? How swiftly did their numbers dwindle? This chronicle of Earth's history revealed to Peters a recurring archaic phenomenon. Around every 100,000 years, Earth enters an interglacial period that vitalizes all species of animals and plants and redistributes life across our planet. As if by silent agreement, on land and at sea, one species after another begins to migrate. Insects and birds, amphibians and reptiles, mammals and fish, and even trees. They strive, en masse, to move closer to the poles, deeper into the oceans, higher up the mountains. They make use of the space left behind by retreating glaciers and masses of ice. If the climate changes again, turning cooler, the species move back. They follow an irresistible force, which attracts and repels them by turns. It's like a dance across the planet, one its inhabitants have performed dozens of times in the last 2.6 million years. Darwin recorded this phenomenon over 150 years ago. In On the Origin of Species, he writes, "On the decline of the glacial period, as both hemispheres gradually recovered their former temperatures, the northern temperate forms living on the lowlands under the equator would have been driven to their former homes or have been destroyed, being replaced by the equatorial forms returning from the south." From nature reserves to prisons. Something leapt out at Robert Peters as he conducted his research. The rate at which trees were migrating was considerably slower than the shift in the climatic zones. Many trees were being left behind, helpless. They were simply too slow. The paleobiologists also had information about animals at their disposal. The chitin shells of bees were sometimes preserved in sediment for thousands of years, as were the bones of small mammals. Their remains revealed that animals were able to react much faster to climate fluctuations than plants, though this was of no use to them if the plants they needed to survive were missing from their new habitats. Peters grabbed some scissors, tape, and tweezers and set to creating a chart of his findings. Computers were not yet widely available. The first image showed a reserve picked at random, with patches of cross-hatching designating a species' natural area of distribution. The second image showed the reserve still within the cross-hatched area, but now surrounded by white patches. These were human settlements and cultivated areas. In the third image, the reserve was now situated outside the cross-hatched area. That is, the climate limits within which the species was able to survive. Peters concluded that the consequences would be worst for those species which are restricted to certain areas, or which share the characteristics of species which are restricted to certain areas. That is to say, those with a limited range, those with small populations which are genetically isolated. The nature reserves of today, he reasoned, would be the prisons of tomorrow. Even if species had the opportunity to migrate in pursuit of their climate zones, their living situations would change fundamentally. A biological community does not migrate to a new place as a cohesive, settled unit, as Darwin imagined. From pollen analysis, paleobiologists have learned that individual species, even individuals of specific populations, advance into new habitats at different speeds. The result is that biological communities, as we know them today, split off into their constituent components. Some species go extinct, while others are able to survive in new places. The groups of species on Earth, Peters came to realize, were nothing but temporary communities of convenience, like a house share where the roommates are always changing. However, this contradicted the prevailing theory of succession, which states that nature will ultimately find its way back to its original state following a disturbance, like storm damage, or human interference, like deforestation. People had this deterministic belief that everything is more or less static, Peters explains, looking back. What we consider to be stable communities are actually artifacts of earlier climatic events. The makeup of species that live together is largely dictated by chance. It was an exciting and terrifying thought, Peters says. Everything could change. And that's exactly what was about to happen. Earth's climate began to change again, the result of humans exploiting and burning much of the planet's fossilized energy resources, as well as razing countless of its forests to the ground. Peters and Joan Darling submitted their article to Bioscience, and an editor at the journal got in touch. He was interested, he said, but since the ideas behind it were so new, 11 peer reviewers would be called in to check the article. Weeks later, they received an update. All 11 reviewers had rejected the article. They argued that it was simply too speculative. Basically, no one believed it, Peters explains. But there were some exceptions. Tom Lovejoy, coiner of the term biodiversity, was one. Another was the editor of the journal, who published the article, despite the peer reviewers' opposition. At least Peters can't say he didn't warn us. The greenhouse effect and nature reserves. Global warming would diminish biological diversity by causing extinctions among reserve species, was published in Bioscience in December 1985, taking pride of place between an article by Edward O. Wilson, the father of modern island biogeography, and one by Michael Soule, the founder of conservation biology. Peters had linked both fields, developing his dystopian vision of the exodus of species and combining it with recommendations on how to proceed. If we are interested in preserving some remnants of the natural world for the year 2100 and beyond, we must begin now to incorporate information about global warming as it becomes available into the planning process. By the year 2000 at the latest, NASA scientists explained, the climate change alarm bell would rise above the usual murmur of natural fluctuations in weather. Most species would then commence their long march across the globe. Global warming made flesh. The most sensitive among them may well have begun a few years earlier. An affront. Sydney, July 1998. Leslie Hughes was nervous as she stepped up to the podium. The aging lecture hall at Macquarie University was packed to the rafters with 700 attendees from across the globe. Next to her on the stage sat professors from the University of Oxford, the Max Planck Institute for Terrestrial Microbiology in Marburg, Germany, and Rutgers University, New Jersey. At least, thought Hughes, she would have the element of surprise on her side as she set her first slide on the overhead projector that afternoon on July 13, 1998. She introduced her talk with a few general remarks, and then she dropped the bombshell. A whole raft of recently published analyses of long-term data sets suggested that some species were already reacting to climate anomalies. The migration of species had begun. Hughes referenced a dozen such cases, including the migration of the little checker spot in the western U.S., as reported by Camille Parmesan. For now, there were only examples of individual species shifting habitat. Yet it seemed inevitable that these isolated responses would grow into a vast cascade, increasingly influencing the composition and structure of biological communities. Hughes invited her audience to take part in a thought experiment. They were to consider the species they worked with from a different perspective. What happens when your species reacts to climate change? She asked. What would it mean for your research if your species started to move several hundreds of miles away? What mattered now was to find out whether more animals and plants had already hit the road, or might do so in the near future. This request came as something of an affront, an attack on the conservationists' worldview. At the time, the prevailing notion was that the balance of species remains more or less stable, and this would persist for years to come. Each species had its ancestral territory. Nature reserves were considered to be the measure of all things. But we don't live in an equilibrium world, Hughes explained to her audience. Eventually, even national parks won't be able to fulfill their role anymore because most of the species will probably have to move out of the protected areas to stay within their climatically inhabitable zones. When Hughes ended her speech, there was friendly applause, and afterward people came and thanked her. They were polite, Hughes recalls, but I don't think most of them felt that what I'd said was groundbreaking. The dawn of a new field of research. It can take a long time for new ideas to take root, particularly among conservationists. The term itself is just a few letters away from conservative. Yet, with her overview of case studies published in Trends in Ecology and Evolution in 2000, Hughes had succeeded in heralding the dawn of a new field of research. Since then, a whole host of biologists have analyzed shifts in the habitats of a diverse range of animals and plants. Initially, Hughes was often the only biologist at conferences concerned with the matter. These days, she finds herself attending conferences where everyone is talking about it. The scientists rose to her challenge. In just a few years, a handful of cases became hundreds, and 2 decades later, tens of thousands. They all confirm that species across the world, from elephants to tiny diatoms in the ocean, are streaming toward the two poles. Land-dwelling organisms are retreating by an average of 10 miles per decade, while ocean-dwelling ones are migrating by as much as 45 miles. Life on Earth's surface is shifting away from the equator at a rate of 16 feet per day, northward in the northern hemisphere and southward in the southern hemisphere. In the oceans, this equates to a distance of 66 feet per day. What's surprising is that we're witnessing this across every continent and in every ocean, the butterfly researcher Camille Parmesan explained when I began looking into the matter, writing an article for Nature and Bild der Wissenschaft. There is no region on Earth where this isn't happening, and there's no group of organisms that isn't affected. How had I not heard about it? I was a little embarrassed. I had been working as a climate journalist since 2012, and yet it was only 4 years ago, and entirely by coincidence, that I came across the story of the mass migration of species, stumbling across a study that mentioned that cod had been reportedly migrating northward as the North Sea warmed. I had to read the sentence again. If cod were migrating to cooler waters, then surely other species of fish could well be doing the same. What if land animals were, too? What if all species were on the move? I could only guess at the consequences it would have for humanity and nature alike, but I suspected they were vast. But I couldn't get more than a couple of select examples from the German conservationists I asked, or from the articles I perused in journals. How could it be that a great redistribution of species was playing out across the globe, such as hadn't been seen for tens of thousands of years, and no one knew anything about it? Except, of course, the biologists who were researching it. I decided to satisfy my curiosity and get to the bottom of it. I sifted through hundreds of scientific studies. It became something of an obsession and earned me the title of best customer at the photocopy shop on the corner. But almost every study would lead me to 3 new studies even more interesting than the last. I interviewed leading figures in the field and spoke to fishermen and foresters, and I traveled all the way to a mountain in the Peruvian tropics to learn more about a process that biologists call the escalator to extinction. I want this book to bring you along with me as I search for clues from the North Pole to the tropics against the current of migrating species as I trace them to their source. I want to understand what will happen when this ancient mass phenomenon encounters modern civilization and turns life as we know it on its head. It already is. Luckily, humanity has had time to adapt. 15 years before this wave swept across the Earth, Robert Peters had reported the phenomenon and warned of its consequences at countless conferences across the U.S. and Europe. He even gave instructions for what we should do about it. The countries of the world should, he said, cut their carbon dioxide emissions in order to limit climate change as much as possible and soften the worst blows to the animal and plant worlds by creating new nature reserves and coming to the aid of migrating species, affording them more space or supporting them to settle in places where they're able to survive. You're probably wondering if any of these measures were ever implemented. That's right, none were. And so, the largest field experiment in history, an ecological catastrophe in no uncertain terms, was allowed to run its course. Part 1. The Arctic. Predators without prey. 1. Hunters. Utqiagvik, Alaska, 2015. The indigenous peoples of the Arctic are the first to notice when the earth seems thrown off balance and the rules that have held true for centuries no longer apply. They live in a region of the world that is heating up faster than the rest of the planet, and they are also more sensitive to changes in their environment. Since time immemorial, many fishermen, reindeer herders, and whalers have depended upon hunting to survive. This applies as much for the Sami in Scandinavia as it does for the Dolgans and Nenets people in Siberia, or the Yupik and Inupiat peoples in Alaska. Every few years, reports emerge of anomalies in the far north. Take, for instance, a story from Utqiagvik, the northernmost town in the U.S., and the place where the Inupiat people have made their living from hunting bowhead whales for generations. On January 29th, 2015, Henry Huntington, a U.S. polar explorer from Eagle River, southern Alaska, made a visit to them. He arrived on an Alaska Airlines flight. All roads in the 4,000-strong town ultimately reached dead ends. 6 days into his visit, the sun decided at last to creep back over the horizon. It had been gone for 2 months, lying low during the polar night. One frosty day, Huntington entered the Inupiat Heritage Center, a long, gray-white, low-rise building, a kind of museum exhibiting the history of the Inupiat and their relationship with nature. Inside, the sea ice expert spread a map of Alaska across a wooden table. The state's north coast forms a triangle with Utqiagvik at its peak. The site had served as winter territory for the Inupiat for centuries. In the 19th century, Europeans began to take an interest in this human outpost and built a whaling station. As time passed, the settlement also attracted meteorologists and biologists, primarily for its location just 200 miles north of the polar circle. Henry Huntington was similarly drawn to the place. He arrived for the first time in 1988, newly graduated from Princeton, hoping to record whale numbers. The job provided an opportunity to get to know the landscape of snow and ice he'd read about in books. In hindsight, he was almost ashamed to have known so little about the people and the nature of the region. Yet the whalers of Utqiagvik welcomed him with open arms. They took him with them onto the ice where they camped out week after week, hunting bowhead whales. When they caught one of these giants, they would haul it up onto the ice to remove its innards and portion it up. Their whole culture revolved around this ancient act. Huntington was captivated and visited again and again. He visited in January 2015 and interviewed 10 of the region's residents one after another, recording conversations with Willie Kunaloik, John Heffel, Ronaldo Ueno, and others. They had plenty to say about the sea ice, where they hunted seals, walrus, and whales. Sea ice is not static. It pulses like an organism, in time with the seasons. In the summer, it retreats northward. In the winter, it descends once more. For many years, the sea in Utqiagvik would typically begin to freeze in October. At the same time, there was also the uneven, thick, multi-annual ice that crept out of the north as far as the coast and anchored itself there. This would provide the inhabitants of this remote area with a huge walkable expanse from one day to the next. All this is a thing of the past now. Sometimes seawater can still be seen sloshing along the coast as late as December, say the locals, some of them dressed in sports jackets and baseball caps. They practically never see the thick pack ice anymore. Without it, however, the newer ice lacks support. It floats and struggles to reform over the winter. Year after year, hunters must travel farther out to sea in their boats in order to reach ice where they can land their catch. But again, in spring, the ice breaks up weeks earlier than it once did, making it dangerous for the inupiat to tread and travel on. Sometimes hunters struggle to find ice sheets thick enough to take the weight of landed bowhead whales. Elsewhere in the world, other residents of the Arctic are increasingly struggling to recognize their home. It must seem utterly bizarre to the nomads and reindeer herders of northern Siberia. They report the ground giving way beneath their feet, whole hills collapsing and roads warping. Rivers now flow where they once felt hard ground beneath their boots. Thousands of lakes have formed, such that the ground resembles little more than a net over the water. The reason for all this is hiding underground. A sixth of the Earth on our planet is permanently frozen, a relic from the last ice age. As Earth warms, the ice in the ground thaws and transforms the whole landscape. The sea ice retreats. The Arctic is shrinking. But this is just the beginning. Hesitant at first, the natural world is reacting to the reconfiguration of the landscape. It's on the move. Plants and animals are migrating en masse into the Arctic from more southerly regions and bringing with them new challenges to local ecosystems. It's hardly surprising that researchers like Huntington are eager to learn from the indigenous peoples of the Arctic. They need their help to understand how climate change is turning life on Earth upside down. To this end, they have equipped traditional hunters with digital cameras, encouraging them to photograph anything out of the ordinary. Or they simply ask them. It began with reports of winters that were not as cold as they used to be. Then there was talk of shrubs slowly but steadily spreading northward as the years grew warmer. And then the animals followed. In 1995, Huntington spoke to Inupiat and Yupik elders in western Alaska about the disappearance of the beluga whale. At one point, he recalls, the conversation took a surprising turn, and suddenly all anyone could talk about was beavers. Huntington must have looked puzzled because one of the old men smiled at him and asked, "Don't you see the connection?" "I don't, to be honest." "The local beaver populations are growing," the old man explained. "They dam the rivers. And that affects the fish. The fish migrate upstream to spawn, and later they return to the sea where they live. The beluga whales wait for the fish where the river meets the sea." Looking back, Huntington can spot early signs of the change. This shift is already throwing ecosystems in the Arctic into disarray, and driving stoic communities like the inhabitants of Utqiagvik to the verge of desperation. A new mammal arrives. Fairbanks, Alaska, March 2017. Ken Tape stared at his computer screen, glancing from one satellite image to the other. Tape is an ecologist at the Geophysical Institute of the University of Alaska. He had heard rumors on one of his expeditions into the Arctic wilderness. A new mammal was said to have begun colonizing the Arctic. Looking at one shot, Tape frowned. He had been working on the Arctic tundra for more than 2 decades. The landscape had hardly changed for many years, except for shrubs and small fields, which were spreading due to the warmer weather. But what Tape saw seemed like someone had taken a hammer to the landscape. In place of the regular river courses visible in older shots, there was now a mosaic of lakes, sections of river, and wetlands, the kind he recognized from stretches of water that had been dammed by beavers. But the rodents had neglected to venture into the tundra thus far. There simply wasn't the food or the building material for their dams. In the days and weeks that followed, Ken Tape and his colleagues examined high-resolution satellite images covering an area almost the size of New Jersey and found 56 beaver lakes that had not been there in 1999.
I've no doubt that we've got some industrious little furry engineers at work here and not some other natural process, Tape explains.
From the distribution of the lakes, the scientists could even determine how quickly the Canadian beaver had spread along the coasts and rivers, an average of 5 miles per year. In 20 to 40 years, Castor canadensis could have colonized the whole of Arctic Alaska, according to a study from 2018. In the intervening years, Tape has discovered thousands of lakes in the Alaskan tundra, all created by beavers. They fell trees, which are rooting farther and farther north, dam rivers, and flood whole stretches of land. Water transfers heat better than tundra vegetation, which means beavers are also causing the permafrost beneath and next to dammed waters to thaw. Experts speculate that these could attract salmon in the future. Another effect is already visible, and it's a particular cause for concern for Tape. Large quantities of greenhouse gases are being released from the ground into the atmosphere.
The great number of lakes are causing the permafrost to thaw dramatically. The beavers are just the latest in a long line of newcomers.
If trees and shrubs are spreading north and the ice is melting, conditions are also improving for others.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.